Team, I would like to start. First of all, you may have gotten at least one, hopefully only one, email from GitHub. That's because we changed the way, the publicity of the sample solutions due to late attendance on the course, blah, blah. So now the sample solutions won't be public anymore. But they are made available to everybody who attempted to solve the exercise. If that sounds unfair to you, text me and I will add you manually to the sample solution. But in general, you can now only access the sample solutions from your GitHub account if you attempted the exercise. So even if you don't do an exercise, the easiest way is to just accept the exercise using GitHub Classroom, and then you're in to be able to see the sample solutions. For that, I needed to add you all to Teams. This is a GitHub feature that you can create teams, and these teams then have repositories they can see. So we made a team for all the sample solutions and added everybody who attempted the exercise. But for that, to be able to join a team in this organization on GitHub, Scientific Programming OS, you have to be a collaborator of this organization. And for that, I cannot make you a collaborator. I can only send you this invite email. And as soon as you accept the invite email, or just go to github.com/scientificprogrammingus, you will see that you should have an invite. And if you have this invite accepted, and as soon as you accepted it, you're automatically a collaborator. That doesn't change a thing for you. It just means that you're now in the team. So as soon as you add it, there are the pending members are here. So as soon as these 75 people accepted the invitation to collaborate to the scientific program OS, you will be able to see the sample solutions. Some people already did. That's one thing. Second of all, I finally made this automatic correction script, and I'm gonna send the emails out with how many homework you passed so far, right after the lecture, I hope, if nothing goes wrong again. And I will also make a startup announcement as soon as I did that. If you did not receive such an email after I made the announcement, text me, write me an email, because I think there are quite a few who didn't connect their GitHub usernames to their EdSet logins. And as I'm sending the email, I'm collecting your repositories, so I got your GitHub username there. And I'm using this roster, which is the thingy from GitHub Classroom, matching your EdSet logins to GitHub usernames. And if your name is not in there, I cannot figure out the corresponding email, or rather EdSet login, to the GitHub account, and that may be messed up. It may even be messed up, maybe it says you have less points than you actually have because you did the first few with your GitHub account and then the other ones with your EdSet login. That may be the case. But in general, for most of you, it should be fine, and I'm going to send the emails. And if you think everything is fine, then you know I passed that and that many homework. And if something is wrong, just text me. In fact, I expect some things to be wrong. Okay. Now the script is finally working well. Okay. Rüdiger did not talk about the last homework last Thursday, did he? Okay. Then I'm going to do that. So, the last homework, the one which was due past Thursday. So that was the one with the first, not the second one to, no, the first one to pandas, and the one with the country data. Oh, that was not supposed to happen. Where am I? Change desktops. Why do you do that? Okay, the one with the countries and the Pokemon. Okay, so first one, find the country with the highest GDP that is neither, okay, so zeroth exercise, describe, look at the columns, look at value columns, blah, blah. I did that already, you did that already, we know what the data set looks like. Okay, so let me do the necessary imports here. In a future lecture, I'm gonna talk about PyCharm and the PyCharm debugger, which is so much nicer. So the interactive kernel is nice to look at homework like this, so I can do stuff like I can't. It's the interactive kernel works to do something like this, like to show you parts of the code, etc. But it's by far not the best version. The visual debugger is so much better, and I think like next week or something I'm going to talk about the PyCharm debugger such that from then on I can show you the homework in the debugger where I can show you all the variables and the like and go through the code step by step, which is so much more useful. Okay, do we have data.g20 here in our interactive kernel? Yes, we do. Okay, so I'm going to make... Okay, I won't be happy with the return. Fuck you. Okay, so what do we do? First, we wanted to get all the countries which are not in this G20 list. So this G20 list is simply a list, as we see, and are not in the EU. And this country's data set did have a column if it is in the EU. So we can simply look for these countries for which this is false, and with the ampersand, because we're binary here, which are not in this G20 list. And then this gives us a Boolean array, or rather a Boolean series with the list, the series with the truth values. And then the non-G20s are all the ones for which this is true. So we get all the non-G20 ones here. And then simply we want to get the one with the highest GDP. So this here selects the respect of the correct row. And then I said I only wanted to have the a series containing the name and its GDP. So we're going to select the country's name and the GDP. And this, because it's only two values, yields in what is series? Is this a series? Apparently this is a series. And this is then Norway. So Norway is neither in the Norway is no G20 country, Norway is not in the European Union. And it has the highest GDP of these, which are not. Okay. All right. Then next, you were supposed to get information about the continent and get this continent data frame. And this is, in fact, we can do this in one line using method chaining, but of course it looks way nicer if we don't do it in one line. So what were we supposed to do? We take two data frames as arguments containing the continents.csv and the countries.csv and return a pandas data frame of continents looking like this. Okay, so what did we want to do? We had this countries where it did have a column for subcontinent but not for continent. So what we wanted to do, well, we have this continents dictionary, or rather this is also a pandas object, but we can simply get for all, so this country subcontinent dot apply for all elements of the series which is returned by country subcontinents, it returns, well, this function, and that it gets the corresponding value at the index of this subcontinent. So we had this, so the continents is a mapper from subcontinent to continent, and using this mapper, so the result of this apply function is a series, and if we add this series as new column to our data set, we have now in our data set, in our data frame, a column continents which contains the continent. Somewhere at the end. Continent. Okay, and then we wanted to have every continent with its population and the number of countries. So There are countries by continents. So what we had to do, obviously, we had to sort the the countries by continent, and then we wanted to have the population, so the sum of all the populations of their countries, and simply the count of countries there. So this is an aggregate, and we want the sum of the population column, and we want the count of the country column. So if we do this, This yields already almost what we want. Just that we still have this nasty, so our index still has a name, and it's obviously not sorted. So the only things we need to do is we need to sort the values. So we wanted to sort by population, so we do that, and descending. And then we wanted to rename country. Oh yeah, this was also the wrong name. Wanted to rename country into countries, or we actually keep the index name. But yeah, this then yields the correct thing. Believe me, it's the right thing. Okay, any questions?
No.
Okay, and then the last thing, Pokemon, was there something wrong with the exercise? No, there wasn't, right? I hope there wasn't. Okay, oh yeah, one thing I forgot. There were a number of people which had the problem that it did work when they ran it manually. So they didn't. So this here was not provided in the task description. So for them it worked when they executed it like this, but it did not work in the test script when using PyTest. So what I recommend if you solve the exercises is to first look at the test and look at how the test does this stuff. What we see here is after asserting a bit of stuff, blah, blah, so these files must be there, it loads in our country's data frame here using pandas.read.csv with the index column 0. If you did not do that, it may have also worked, but you didn't have, well, the first column is the index, but you created a new index column. And then it worked differently because pandas handles the index differently than a normal column. So if you're attempting to solve these exercises, just look at the test script, look at the test script, read stuff before using the functions which you were supposed to write on this, and do it the same way such that you don't break compatibility to the test script. So I always load it with the index column 0 because I wanted to have, for example, in this case, the country name as the index, or the continent name here as the index, which was the first column. So for Pokemon, I think, oh no, I did that for Pokemon 2, because the index of the Pokemon no duplicate CSV was simply a number, and that's a perfect index, right? Okay, what did we want to get? We wanted to find the Pokemon with the best stats that can defend the most common type combination there is. So at first we find the most common type combination there is. How can we do that? Well, we simply go for a simple group by, right? So we have we group by both types, and then select the column name and count the number of names, and then I reset the index to make it look nicer, and then I renamed it to look nicer again because this now corresponds to the count and not to the name of the Pokemon again. So now we have, because we resetted the index, we have a data frame with three columns, so type 1, type 2, and the count. So now we want to get the most common type. We simply want to get the type combination where count is the highest. So, yeah. You're right. Oh yeah, I should have.
I think it was not the case.
It was, yeah, that was what I'm, yeah, you're right. So I should have done that. So I shouldn't have simply looked for, so I should have made, so I don't know, I could have sorted type 1 and type 2. Yeah, I would have to go through every single row. And for example, like sort type 1, the value of type 1 and type 2 alphabetically such that they're on the correct order. You're right, I needed to do that. That was what I meant. So I was really scared that I make a mistake like this and it changed the sample solution. Okay, it didn't change the sample solution, luckily, but that was a mistake. Yes, I should have counted type 1, type 2, and type 2, type 1 being the same. Yeah, you're right. Okay, but imagine we did that and that's now smart somewhere in type nums. I don't attempt to do that right now because it maybe takes a bit longer because I'm confused. But then what we simply wanted, well, we wanted the maximum value for count And then we wanted to get, well, type 1 and type 2. And I also make a list out of that here, such that I can simply add that to two variables. So now it's simply two variables. You don't need to do it. You can stay in pandas all the time. It just was easier for me, such that I have it simply in a variable. Good. Then we had this effectivity attack table. There were many not a numbers. I filled them with a 1 because it's just intuitively right now. So you have the multiplicator of 1. Doesn't matter. You didn't need to do that. It didn't change a thing because we're looking for the effective types anyway. Good. And now the effectivity attack. So pandas always selects columns, right? So if we want to get, an attacker, so if we want to go for an attacker, it makes more sense to, so if we want to figure out an attacker, we want to have the attacker in the column and not in the row, which is why I made a new table effectivity depend, which is simply the transpose of that. I could have also selected rows, but natively pandas is better at extracting columns and faster at extracting columns, so that's what I did here. Yeah, and then I simply selected the ones which could worst, no wait, what did I do here? So where the defend of our type, so if we look at effectivity defend now, what do we see here? So the attacker is now here, and we wanted to have these ones where the defender for a type, we wanted to get these columns where this type as defender was bad. So we looked at all the ones where type 1 and type 2 were bad and wanted to get the indices of that because this then is the attacker column. So this yields defender type 1, defender type 2 is walk and steal. And now I did remember that the order is important and I made it explicit so that there may be walk steal and steal walk Pokemon. And I made it explicit by simply asking, well, give me all Pokemon where either the type 1 is type 1 and type 2 is type 2, or where type 1 is type 2 and type 2 is type 1. I could have also asked for, give me all Pokemon where the type 1 is in defender type 1, defender is in like a list of defender type 1 and defender type 2, and also type 2 is in this list of defender type 1, defender type 2, because there's no steel Pokemon, and that would have the same effect. This is just more explicit. Yeah, and this then yielded a list of walk steel Pokemon, and then we simply took the one with the best stats, which was Agwon. So we got Agwon. All right, any questions to that? Okay, then let's get to the content of this week. So this week, the lecture is called Analyzing Data with Pandas, which is in fact simply the rests we didn't cover in the previous lectures, which are special data types, pivot tables, and time series in Pandas. So Pandas was originally made by a guy who did time series with that. So Pandas is very native support for time series, and it's basically made for time series, which is why it's good thing. So we have the usual imports, pandas, numpy, matplotlib, and we also import seaborn. This is a plotting library which interacts really nicely with pandas. We're going to look at a few plots only, and there's going to be a lecture in 2 weeks or something about seaborn and other plotting libraries, which covers that in more details. Okay, first of all, two data types. So data, there are several levels of measurement, Skalenniveaus. I think this was already covered in Statistik by Stauffenbiel. But yeah, so data can be expressed in several types of measurement, and we need to figure out which makes more sense, both semantically and computationally. So the easiest level is simply the nominal level, where numbers don't correspond to numbers, but simply represent categories and nothing more, and the order is basically random. for example, a gender. So we could represent male as 1 and female as 0. We could also represent male as 0 and female as 1. Doesn't change a thing. So there's only a difference between these numbers, but no inherent order or something. Same for colors, same for many other things. And for data on a nominal level, it only makes sense to compute absolute and relative frequencies and the modes, so the most common element of this. So if there are more females than males, then we could get, then the mode would be female, right? Everything else does not make sense. Like, it doesn't make sense to compute an average gender because, well, if there are like 99 men and 1 female, the average gender would be either 0.99 or 0.01, and that obviously doesn't make any sense, so don't do that. And make sure when you have variables on the nominal level that you forbid to do stuff like calculating the mean or something. And that's why we want to take variables on a nominal level, we make a categorical variable such that we forbid other people to calculate, for example, a mean from these, because it doesn't make sense, and if somebody did that, it would seriously hurt your data set and just be wrong. Okay, next level is the ordinal level. So numbers are still categories, but these categories are ordered, and the order has a meaning. So for example, a Likert scale. So if you have this psychology test and it says weight on a scale of 1 to 7, where 1 means completely disagree, 3 means neutral, and 7 means completely agree. So the order now has a meaning, but we don't know if the difference between completely disagree and disagree a bit is the same difference between neutral and agree a bit. So we wouldn't make any assumptions about order, and about if we don't make any assumptions about the order and about differences in the order, and if they are the same, then we're at the ordinal level. Other examples are school grades. Is a 2 the same distance from a 1 than a 6 is from a 5? In fact, it's not, because if you translate it to points, between 5 and 6 there are less points, etc. And yeah. So if you have variables on an ordinal level, we can, of course, compute the absolute and relative frequencies again. It still makes sense. The mode still makes sense. But additionally, we can calculate cumulative frequencies, the median, and quantiles. So we can now talk about where we have sorted data, we have ordered data, and now it makes sense to say, well, the median, so the 50% point of the data is there and there, because the median doesn't require ordering, because, well, it's only one of the values you already have. And quantiles make just as much sense, and we can also add like the number of students which have at least a good, so at least the grade 2 in this exam is simply the number of students which have a 1 and a 2 in this exam. So cumulative frequencies also make sense. And then we're getting to the levels where numbers do make sense, which is first of all the interval level, which means that same intervals should convey the same meaning. So the difference between 10 degrees Celsius and 0 degrees Celsius is certainly the same as between 20 degrees Celsius and 10 degrees Celsius. The difference between 1 IQ point doesn't is the same amount of intelligence, for example, between 100 and 99 and 70 and 69. Now the mean also makes sense, because the numbers are on an ordinary scale, and on an ordinary scale, the mean makes sense, and we can also calculate the standard deviation, so the distance of the individual points. And then, at last, there's the ratio level. Ratios, so, and of course, on the interval level, you can calculate everything you can calculate on the ordinal level too. And then, lastly, there's the ratio level. And on the ratio level, it's basically the same as interval level, but there is a specific zero point. For example, temperature in Kelvin makes sense, because is on the ratio level, because Kelvin has a certain zero point and there's nothing that goes below that. Mass, there's nothing that has a negative mass, size, time, speed. So all the cases where a zero point is there, and for example, and most of all, it's a useful zero point. And because of that, we can also calculate the coefficient of the variation, so the normalized standard variation, which is a more useful measure because if we have temperatures on a scale, like if we have higher numbers, the coefficient of variation is a different number than we'd have the same distances basically on lower numbers. And if it's on an interval level, I don't have an important zero point, and I can simply shift the numbers. So from Celsius to Fahrenheit, I simply add a number and divide by a number, and then I went from Celsius to Fahrenheit. And if I create a new temperature scale, which is the Celsius plus 10,000, like all the numbers, the standard deviation and so on would just be, the standard variation would be much higher, obviously, but it's still, like, it's the same scale, just with plus 10,000. And on a ratio level, you could not do that anymore, because if I simply add 10,000 to my degrees Kelvin, I cannot take, it's not a ratio level scale anymore, and the coefficient of variation is disallowed for me. So the coefficient of variation is defined as the standard deviation divided by the mean, which is supposed to be scale invariant. So I do not add 10,000 and it changes the thing, but if I have a certain mean, my mean is a certain number, which is the same for all data points, then it makes sense. Okay. And if you have data, you should know which level of measurement, which scale niveau you're on, and only calculate stuff which your scale niveau allows you. And to make sure that you don't accidentally calculate stuff which is not on your scale niveau, Pandas has a type for categorical data. So normally we had numbers and we had objects, which are basically only strings in Pandas, but Pandas also provides a data type for categorical data. And using this data type has advantages. For example, it makes the data usable for numeric modeling algorithms, which makes sure, hey, I want this special data type, and I don't work if you have other data types, because you may be on the wrong level of measurement. Of course, it keeps memory usage low. So if I have, a data frame where there's 10,000 values, which are each like a 100 signed string, but in the end it's all the same string. I could represent the string by one bit and simply have a translation. This bit means this string. If I have a string in every single row of that, well, I have 10,000 times this 100 byte string, and this is of course a waste of memory. Yeah, it signals to libraries that build on Pandas how to treat the data, like I said, and they expect the correct level of measurement, and it makes the intent clear. So if we create a series, this is simply a normal series, and look at the size. Well, this series is 48 bytes big, so there's a lot of overhead because Pandas has a lot of methods and stuff, so it must produce a lot of overhead. And if we, by at creation, explicitly tell, well, I want to have it in a data type category, then we see where we don't have the object here anymore, but the category, and Pandas also tells us that, well, these categories have three objects, namely A, B, and C, and they can represent this only with number here. So this is internally a 1, and 1 maps to A, this or 0. This is internally a 1, 1 maps to B, this is internally a 2, 2 maps to C. So using this makes the series much smaller already. So this is only 30 bytes, because I can use numbers here instead of having to use the at least ASCII, probably UTF-8, which requires 2 bytes per number already. So much, much smaller, and especially in larger series, this is a really, really big difference, because most of these 30 bytes are the overhead by Pandas, and they are the same size if you have like 10 billion times the amount. So this 18-bit byte makes a lot of difference in bigger series. Okay, like I said, under the hood, categorical data is stored using numeric codes that simply map to categories. So I have the categories here. This is the same as it tells me here. So I have categories A, B, C. And then I have the codes, and I see that under the hood, like I said, 0 maps to A, 1 maps to B, and 2 maps to C. So under the hood, this is simply an array of type int 8. So I have only 1 byte here per number, per cell, which is much, much less. Okay, so these categories are unordered by default. So if we simply have dtype equals category, Panda assumes we're on the nominal level. And we are, for example, concerning genders or something, which don't have an order. I could also, I can also ask, are the categories here ordered? No, they are not. And like there is, Rüdiger showed you last week the .str accessor for variables which are a string, so which cells which are in fact a string. And the .cat accessor allows accessing where the fact that it's a category. So I can ask for stuff like, is this category? So I know the series contains categories, and are the categories ordered. And just like that, it also provides methods. For example, the method rename categories. And if I know here, I have my s.cat. Categories. Yep. This is only an accessor object, as we see here. And if I rename, then I see, so I can simply map first one, second one to second one, third one to third one. So ABC becomes XYZ. And because I changed the categories here, this mapper maps now to other things. Okay. We can also create a series from this pd.categorical, and this allows to set the categories and also an ordering explicitly, so we can now make ordered categories which are on level of measurement 2, so on the ordinal level. And additionally, I can say, for example, that I only have less, like if I have less categories than this, other things will occur. So I see here I don't have a category for A, yeah. And there are A's, so I don't have a category for A, but there are A's in my data. And then Pandas will say, well, this is not a number or not a category. So Pandas uses, for missing values, Pandas always uses not a number. And this is simply a missing value. So I can add this. Of course, I can add the A here, and everything is fine now. But if I only have less categories and I have stuff which is not in these categories, it makes sense sometimes to have them not a number. Yeah, now we have this categorical, which is not a series yet, but this Pandas categorical. But we can simply pass this constructor, so this entire thing, we simply paste into a series, and we create a series of data type categories. Good. As much for the normal categories, now let's go to the ordinal level. Let's go for ordered categories. Well, what does it mean to have ordered categories? Well, like I said, on the first level of measurement, it makes sense to, for example, I can ask if some person's gender is another person's gender, and it makes sense to sort to compare. It doesn't make sense to, for example, sort. Like, is the gender of one person higher than the gender of another person? Obviously, doesn't make sense. I hope obviously. So for my unordered categories, like I said, I can compare. I made two series here. And I can compare if the elements are the same here. But it does not make sense to ask if the one is bigger than the other, because unordered categories can only compare equality or not. Makes total sense. But like I said, I can get the mode. I can get the most common value, which in my first series, I already forgot what it was A. So like I said, first level of measurement, I can calculate the mode. And again, the max doesn't make sense because, like I said, they're unordered. Good. This semantics is only in the entire series, and if we pull out an atomic value, I lose the fact that it used to be this categorical. So this is simply an A. And if I look at its type, I see that it's only a string anymore. And now I can compare that, because, well, strings have the compare function. Which is, what is it? str dot underscore underscore less. No, it doesn't. I don't know what the dunder method is named, but because strings have this less function, I can obviously compare to strings. So only the series categorical, not the values. Make sure that you never use that wrongly. Okay, now let's try the same for an ordered categorical series. So I now simply say ordered equals 2, and it will infer the order simply by, well, the order of how I put the categories in here. So B is smaller than C, which is smaller than A. And if I print that, pandas will also tell me that B is smaller than C is smaller than A. I can, of course, change that afterwards, but this is the way how I created it now. Now if I make another ordered series where the order is the same, B, C, A, I can ask if the one series is bigger than the other, and then what pandas will do for every single element, it will look if, according to this ordering here, the A, the first one, is bigger than the second one. Now, because they're ordered, taking the max also makes sense. So A is the max category, so if there is an object of type A in here, then it would return A. So if I made an additional category, I need to make the category here too, because otherwise it will complain. And well, it's still A, because D would be the biggest, but there's no D in there. Yes, and they're obviously, they're not equal, because, well, this is just the method to get. So if I didn't want to ask for every single element, right? So this compares every single element. If I want to know simply if they're exactly the same, I can use the equals method. I showed you this, I think, 2 weeks ago. Median still doesn't really work, but we can compute it from the codes if needed. So if we look at the cut.codes, we see that this now simply has the numbers here, and what was the series again? So, so these are the codes. So these are the indices, and this is the code of the category, and they are ordered. So the lowest one always is 0, and it goes until the number of categories that are in there. And from that, I can take then the median. And in this case, the median is 1.5, which lies in the middle between C and A. So it doesn't make, so I can't express the median in a category, because it's right in the middle between the categories, which is why pandas doesn't allow to calculate the median, but it's still a useful measure and it still makes sense on this level of measurement. Okay, if we have existing data, what we want to do is, well, imagine we have a series here, which is now obviously strings. What we want to do is use this pandas.categoricalDtype to create our own categorical data type, which works the same as our categorical, except that here we don't pass the data, but use where's our series? We first create the categorical D-type, and then this is only a data type, and then we create the actual series. We cast it into our category type. So now our series is of type categories. Okay, so let's look at a real-world data set to see where it makes sense to do that. And what I have for you is the Titanic data set. It's from the Kaggle competition. So Kaggle is the site which makes all these machine learning competitions for many, many tasks. And the Titanic data set is really a starter data set, because machine learning doesn't make much sense on that, because it's not that big of a data set, and neural networks would obviously be much of an overkill. But it makes sense to use this data set to explore. I didn't find any information on whether this falls under the GDPR, because there obviously some passenger names on there, but maybe they're too old anyway. So I'm not sure if I can show it, but I'm just gonna, because Kaggle didn't explicitly state that I can't. So I'm just gonna show this data set. Oops. Ah, no. Okay. So let's look at our data set. We have the passenger ID, which is simply a number. We have the fact if the person survived or not. Class, the passenger class, or rather, so the like first class, second class, third class, like an airplane. We have the name, the sex, the age. I forgot what this was, and what this was, and what this was. The price they paid, the number of the cabin, and in which city they embarked. And what do we see here? Well, if we look at the data types, so the ID is a number, this makes sense. If they survived, it's a number. This doesn't really make sense, because this is simply a Boolean, so this is already a waste of space. The passenger class, I think it's only 1, 2, 3, so this is obviously a huge waste of space. 2 bits would be enough here. Name is object makes sense. Sex is object. This is awful because there's a string every time where a bit would be enough. Age is float. That makes sense because the youngest passenger is 0.42 or something. So this somehow makes sense. Blah, blah, blah. Embarked again is an object where a category would be better. So let's look at the description of our data set. If we have this include equals all, I didn't show that 2 weeks ago. So if we don't have the include equals all, it will only describe the numerical columns and not the object columns. And if we have this include equals all, it will also describe the object columns. But as we see, they are differently described than the numerical columns, because in object columns, like, only the mode makes sense, like the most common, the most frequent value. The count of values makes sense, the number of unique values makes sense for objects. But for example, everything that needs an ordering doesn't make sense because pandas knows its level of measurements and objects are on the zeroth level of measurement, or rather on the first, they are categories, but really bad categories because there are really many of them, right? Every single string per category, that would be a lot. So yeah, what do we see? Embarked only has three different values, so this is a waste of space. Sex only has two different values, obviously. Not obviously, but still. So this makes sense. This doesn't make sense. And same holds for a few other things. But the ones we want to change right now are embarked and sex. So what do we change? So how do we change it? Well, first of all, let's make a quick mapper from this embarked city to the long version, which was not in the original dataset because it was a waste of space, and the original dataset is saved as a CSV file, and CSV files are not able to represent this pandas category. So if you save something with pandas categories to a CSV, it will simply add all the category numbers with the string which belongs, which is the name of the category, and you have the same overhead again. So every time you load something from a CSV, you have to make it categorical again to have it small in the RAM, because CSV is simply a shitty data file, simply a type of data, and doesn't allow for these categories and for the small overhead. Okay, so let's make the embarked long. So what we do here is we merge. Rüdiger showed you last week what merging is, and we simply merge it by, well, embarked. So this column exists here, this column exists here, so pandas knows what to do, and simply adds for every, so for every embarked equals S, it will at this column, for every embarked equals C, it will add this row, I mean, and so on and so on. So merging makes sense. Now we have this embarked long in here. But this is even worse because embarked long is now also an object, and this is really shitty, and it only has three distinct values, so it makes sense. So we see three distinct values, so it makes sense to represent it using categories. So we simply say S type category, and then if we look at this column, at the first five elements of this column, we see that now it's of D type category. It still shows the entire name because pandas are smart, but it's stored way, way better, way more efficient. You see, this is of type category. Yeah, and if we describe it, so categories have the description, which is basically the same as for an object column. So it gives me the count, the number of unique values, the top, so the mode, and the amount of values. Okay, let's do the same thing for the sex column. Oops. Okay, just same thing as we did before, just to give you some kind of an exercise. So same code as before, I just want you to do something such that you don't sleep. And well, let's make the sex column the same column as before, but it's type category, and we see here now it's of type category. Okay, next thing about discrete value, about categories as values is discretizing continuous values. So, for example, imagine we wanted to check if children are, like, if children survived better than adults. Then we want to discretize the age, for example, into, well, you're a child, you're under 18, and you're not a child, you're over 18. So sometimes it makes sense to convert numeric data into categorical data. So, like I said, the exact age might not matter, but only if the person's underage or not. Converging this is called tiling. So let's look at the age. It's obviously a float. We have the minimum number is 0.42. And then we see here the percentiles, the quantiles rather, and the mean and the standard deviation. Using cut, we can discretize numeric values. So these are the first values. And if we use this pandas.cut and say, I want three bins, this discretizes our age into the ranges 0.34 until 26.947, 26.947 exclusively, until 53.473, and the last category is 53.that until 80. So now Pandas made different cuts. And why did it make this cut? Well, because Pandas wanted to split the data into equally sized intervals. This makes sense somehow, so you can use these categories now to extract, for example, the 33rd percentile, but it doesn't make much sense, and we normally don't want that. So we can set, obviously, the bin edges ourselves by setting not the scalar here, but simply the numbers. So now this makes bins from 0 to 17, 17 to 67, and 67 to 18. So now we get these categories here. This include lowest simply says that the zero should be in the very first one. And like normally, all the other ones, the 17 is part of the first category, but not of the second category. So you can't change the fact that every interval from the second on is exclusive on the left side and inclusive on the right side. Okay, so yeah. So the first seven passengers, the first five, are all adults, neither seniors nor children, where there was a missing value, and it's still a missing value, of course, and yeah, that's also an adult. Okay, so if we look at the value counts, we can now, for example, see where there are almost 600 passengers which are adults, there are 113 passengers which are children, and we see here, because I made this include lowest equals two, Pandas made this even a negative 0.01. I have no clue why Pandas does that. So if I don't have the include lowest equals 2, Pandas will make the lowest category 0.34, even though the youngest passenger is 0.42. I did not figure out why Pandas, why this distance. I mean, probably makes sense under the hood, but it's just, I mean, it's certain that all the values are in there, and why Pandas uses a bound which is so much lower than the necessary bound, I don't know. So yeah, and we have seven seniors in here. Yeah, if I didn't have this include lowest here, it would start at a zero. Don't ask me why Pandas does this. Yeah, if we set the edges manually, we have to cover the whole range as well, because all the values not falling into a given interval, like if we have a category not given, will simply be not a number. So if we have the columns, the cuts here from 64 until 80, so 64 until 66, 66, 67, and 67 until 80, well, obviously, most of the passengers are missing values because, well, there's no category for that. Okay, let's make a normal age coarse column. So this here adds this age coarse column, which simply says if somebody is a child, a grown up, or a senior. So this is the correct way to do that. Okay, then there's Q-cut, which cuts at quantiles. So what do we see here? We have, so we see these here are our quantiles. So we wanted to create three quantiles, and they are from this child. Now that's a correct way. So this type on 0.42 and 0.419 seems to be a correct order for me, until 23, until 34, and until 80. So what means cutting at the quantiles. So let's look at the distribution of our data using pandas plotting tools. And now this shows you also the next nice thing, and that is that it's really easy to plot with pandas. So I can simply say, make me a histogram from the age distribution, so from our age series, and I want the densities here. So this is simply a pandas method, which internally, as we see here, creates something. So this uses internally the matplotlib function. So this makes a matplotlib function. This calls matplotlib using our pandas series, just with the advantage that all the labels and so on are already in the way pandas wants and needs them. So pandas plotting tools just calling the corresponding matplotlib functions, but are more convenient, and they do not require to move NOTA numbers, for example. Pandas simply ignores them, which you have to know. You have to know that the NOTA numbers are ignored. But it makes sense. So if we wanted to have the equivalent plot for matplotlib, where we could simply, we have to first drop the DNA, like I said, and then we get the values. And then this here now yields a NumPy array, I hope. Yeah, this looks like a NumPy array. And if we make a histogram from that, where we can simply use matplotlib.hist. Same thing. Only that, for example, pandas also activates the grid here and stuff. So what does qcut do? So far we looked at the age, not at the age.qcut. But if we cut this qcut, it divides the data such that bins, that an equal number of values will fall into each bin. So if we see that, and if we make a bar plot using these numbers here, so what? Let's look at what we actually did here. We created three numbers, and the height is the amount of values, yeah, for all of the results from qcut. So qcut has these three different values, these three different categories, I mean. And if we, value count, where we simply ask how many are in there in each category, and if we get the values, we get a NumPy array, and we see that it almost makes three bars of the same height. So as the numbers besides this 0.42-year-old child are all integers, it's not perfect, and there are a few more here than here, but this is the best cut pandas could make. Good. Like I said, real quick, also seaborn. Seaborn is nice because it renders everything, every pandas data frame really nicely natively, simply, and it's called really simply. So I don't have to convert, like extract the values from here. I simply have to call this pandas, give me a quantile cut with three or let's say four numbers, and then make a countplot of that. So seaborn.countplot. This expects some kind of pandas data frame as input, and tada, we see they are roughly the same thing. And we also see, wow, seaborn is so nice. So seaborn plots me already the count here, it plots me the categories here, everything. Just different colors, everything the way I wanted to have. So seaborn is a really nice package. We're going to look at it in a bit. Okay, what did I do here? So we wanted to count. Ah, yeah, these are, well, the counts. So like I said, it's not perfect. It's 34%, 32%, 32%. But we're thinking like the next. So we wanted to have this a bit less. So let's make it not 23, but 22. And now we have 32, and if we have 23 not here too, then we would have 32, 34 here. Well, let's try to make to shift this border too, and we see already this doesn't make much sense, because now we're at the same problem, 32, 32, 40, 34, so there's no perfect cut. Pandas makes the best one. Okay, I'm plotting with pandas, just as a real quick insertion, and pandas is really nice, like I said, because it offers the plotting functions, which simply base on matplotlib's corresponding function and also internally call these functions. Now we may say, well, this plot here is bad for me because I don't have, for example, axis labels. That's true, but you can simply add axis labels by telling it, well, plot this on such and such matplotlib axes. So if we simply make this, this gives us this plot, which we cannot change afterwards, which is not good. The same thing, this is the same thing as if we were plotted matplotlib. So like I said, I make a NumPy array from this, and I use matplotlib to plot this. And for example, imagine I wanted to have the age as the x label. This would be easy in matplotlib. I simply have to call, well, this figure dot this matplotlib.subplots to make a figure object and an axis object, axes object. And then I can simply not call plt.hist, which is this state machine interface, MATLAB style, never use it. It's just not a correct object-oriented way to code. And obviously, Python users are better than MATLAB users, so we don't use the state machine interface, and we always create an object and let this and use methods on the objects instead of the state machine interface. I don't know if Rudiger said that to you, so I wanted to say that to you. And yeah, so from these axes object, we can make a histogram, and then on these axes object, we can set, for example, the x label, which is the age. But this is just as easy in pandas because I can simply tell, so this is the matplotlib version, which doesn't have the grid. I don't know, I used a different backend when I first executed it, so it all looks a bit different when I recompiled it. Never mind for you, different backend, doesn't change a thing. But just like that, I can do the same in MATLAB, in pandas. I can simply, well, again, make my figure object, my axis object, and simply on this hist method, provide my axes object such that now pandas prints it on these axes, and on these axes I can do the same stuff I could do in NumPy before. So I can, for example, set the x label of h. I could also turn off the grid. Does anybody happen to know the correct method for that? I could Google that, but that takes too long, so never mind. I could turn off the grid just like that. Okay. And for example, what I can also do, so there's not only this .hist function method, there's also the .plot method. And in the .plot method, I can even specify which kind of plot I want. So I can make a pie plot, I can make a bar plot, I can make scatter plots, blah, blah, blah. It's all listed, no, not here, it's somewhere below. Here. So these are all the stuff I can plot. And like I said, so in this case, it doesn't make sense to plot the age course itself because, what is the error actually? Fill value must be in categories. I didn't get rid of this, but this doesn't make sense anyway because, well, if we simply take the age course, it's a bunch of numbers, and so it's a bunch of categories, even with not a numbers in there. So this doesn't make sense for a bar plot. What we want to give a bar plot are the value counts. So these here are simply this and this category, this and this many values. This pandas understands and can make a plot out of this. So we see it's already perfectly labeled, just the way we want it to have. Yeah, like I said, in the original edge course, I had many not a numbers in there. Because, well, for some passengers, we just didn't know the age. And these not a numbers are still here in my age coarse, which is not a good thing because I don't want one numbers in there. So I could make a category, and I could add a category using this category.cat assessor, which I already told you before, and then add category unknown. Now we have a new category. So if we look at the categories, there's also the category unknown. And now I can call fill NA unknown, which fills all the NAs which are not with the category unknown. If this was not be my category, I could not do that because the fill value must be in the categories. I cannot fill the NAs using something which is not a given category, so I first must add the category, and then I can fill it using this category. And now if we look at the value counts from this, we see that there are quite a few unknown ages. And maybe we want our plot to show that too. So this would be the plot including the unknown ages. So these are the numbers for all the known ones. So this would be the extrapolated, what we think the Grundgesamtheit, the base would be. And this is what our data set actually looks like. Okay, just as much as we can plot using kind equals pi, we can also use kind equals horizontal bars. But not even using categories here in pandas prevents you from making stupid plot. So this would be a kernel density estimation plot, which obviously does not make sense for all four categories here. So pay attention that you use the white plots, only the white plots. And these are all the kinds of plot pandas provides you. And like I said, it simply calls matplotlib internally anyway. So yeah. So time for a new exercise. Plot the distribution of males and females in a bar plot. Rotate the x-sticks of the resulting plot by 25 degrees like we did in the fifth homework, I think. So this is what it's supposed to look like, this rotated x-sticks. But because I wanted to change the x-sticks labels, I do need the accessor for my axes object, so I may have to make the object, my axes object itself, so I have to call plt.subplots. And then so this is just one way to normalize this. There would be also a way of simply using histogram, but this is just another way I use here to normalize this. So this gives simply where the value counts divided by the amount of sexes in general, which normalizes them to one, such that they sum up to one. And yeah, then we simply plot that. We wanted to have horizontal bars, and we need our axis object, because in the end, we wanted to give the tick labels, where the tick labels are the sex, which is there anyway, but unfortunately not rotated the way I want to have it, so I need to tell that again, so otherwise I would overwrite it, I think. And yeah, horizontal alignment white, rotation 25 degrees, just as it was in the homework. Okay, and lastly, for working with categorical data, let's look at how we convert stuff to numeric data. So sometimes our numeric data is screwed up somehow, and our pd.numeric handles these cases and automatically casts into the appropriate type. So imagine somebody gave you this data set, this numeric data.csv, and we see here that this here is an NA, and this here is not available. So apparently, I don't know, it's collected by different people, and the different people had different ideas of what a not available token would need to look like. And if we convert that, if we read the CSV and make a data set out of this, and look at the D types, we see that, well, both of them are object columns and not numbers. And that's not what I wanted, right? So obviously, both people meant that this is simply a not available data type, so an np.nan would be correct. And if we, so, but as they are object columns, if we take the sum, well, it will take the sum method for strings, so string plus string is simply the concatenation of the two strings, and this is certainly not what I wanted to have. Okay, so what can I do? Well, I can simply convert the column to, for example, integer. And this works for the column B, because even though NumPy pandas reads it as a float, these are all even numbers, are all integers, so I can simply convert it to an integer type, and that works. But what happens if I try to coerce my first column with this not available in there to int, to a float, for example? Well, pandas tells me, nope, could not convert this string to a float. And this is, of course, pretty bad, because then I would never be able to make my column to floats. But, of course, there's this pd.toNumeric, and I can simply give it a series and tell it what it needs to do with errors. So it can either erase errors, in which case this error message would be erased. It can ignore them, and if there is, so if we have errors equals ignores, it will simply, as soon as it finds one single element which is not able to coerce without problems, it will simply leave the row as an object row. So if I made errors equals, I think it was ignore, then it would stay an object row because pandas would simply say, meh, cannot do. But we can also coerce these. And if we have errors equals coerce, it will simply make everything which it can't convert to not a number, which is what we want. Same thing for column B. We see, well, it doesn't change a thing here. For column C, we see we have one not a number again. ToNumeric is only defined on series, so if I have a data frame, it doesn't work. But luckily, there's this apply. So I can simply on my numeric data. Numeric data was my original data frame. And I can simply apply. So for all these columns, please use the function pd.numeric. And keyword arguments are simply provided in the .apply method, and they are passed to the respective function here. And this makes, well, I didn't show the dtypes, so this doesn't make much sense. Ta-da, this makes all floats. Good. Then I told you 2 weeks ago, I think, that if you have an NaN in a column, it always needs to be a float because the np.NaN is of instance float. Is that actually true? np.NaN is of instance float. And that was rather annoying. And that was true until a few months ago, when Pandas with version 0.24 added integer and a support. Yay! You demanded it, now you get it. So since January of this year, Pandas can finally hold integer data types with missing values. So first of all, make sure that I have actually version 0.24. Yes, I do. And then, yeah, remember how annoying it was to have a single missing value for our data frame here, because the attempts would be an integer actually, but because there's one missing value, it must be a float, and that's really, really annoying. But Pandas can now represent integer data with possibly missing values using arrays.integerArray, which is a so-called extension type. That means this type is implemented in Pandas itself and not like all the other data types we've seen so far borrowed from NumPy. And it's not the default data type for integers yet. It may be changed in a future version of Pandas and probably will, and will not be inferred, but we must explicitly pass this data type into the constructor. So this here, our XM data. We had that before, and if we simply call the constructor on our XM data, it will make a float out of this. But if we tell it, well, use the dtype capital I int 8, so if we didn't have the capital I, it wouldn't work because this here is the new data type, which is the same as pandas.int8 dtype, then ta-da, we have integers with not a number in there. This is awesome. Yeah, and they only took years for that. But yeah, it automatically coerces, for example. So if I add to this column, if I add a float, Pandas will automatically coerce and make all numbers here float. And now np.nan is also, is well, still here. So this is a new data type, the nullable integer data type, which is int 64 with a capital I, or int 8 with a capital I. So never mind, just the capital I is important. And yeah, if we want to use this dtype, we made this series here, 1, 2, and an, using our new data type. And as column B, we have this series with normal integers, and this here are objects. We see that the data types of column 1 and 2 are different, because this here is the nullable integer data type, and this here is the normal integer data type. So if we wanted to make, if we wanted to make this here, oh, this was the wrong way, that was stupid. I also keep forgetting all the time. So I wanted to change the data type of this, Pandas would need to coerce because, well, this was the lowercase I. Okay, as much for the nullable integers, really useful thing, quite new. Yay. Okay. Then the second big topic for today, and the last one will be for Thursday, of course, because I'm always too slow, but never mind that. Exploratory data analysis. So, what is exploratory data analysis? Well, it's simply just looking at your data and trying to make sense of it. So, exploratory data analysis describes the process of building up an intuition for our data. So we look at data transformations and so we transform the data a bit such that it's in the correct way. We look at visualizations of the data. And yeah, so we're gonna do exploratory data analysis using Pandas and not much visual tools here. And next week, yeah, I think next week and in 2 weeks and in 3 weeks, two of these 3 weeks, we will do that visually using Seaborn and other plotting libraries. Okay, so exploratory data analysis is simply the process of building up an intuition for my data. So I need to understand my data. I need to know sensible ranges and stuff. So if I made, for example, a model for my data and produces complete crap, I couldn't tell if I haven't looked at my data. So look at your data first, evaluate such that you can, in the end, evaluate if the results of your model, for example, make sense or complete bollocks. Okay. So typical steps in the process of exploratory data analysis, we research the fields of the data set, we try to figure out what the corresponding value, what possible values are, what sensible ranges are, etc., etc. Then we form hypotheses and develop investigation themes to explore. So if we have a data set, so for example, in Titanic data set, it makes sense, it's interesting to look at if, for example, females survived with a bigger chance than males or something. So that would be a hypothesis which our data set could answer. Wrangle data, so we arrange data and stuff, assess the quality of our data, look how many np.nans are in there. Profiling, we'll look at profiling in a second. Yeah, explore each individual variable, and after exploring each variable individually, assessing the relationship between each variable and the target. So our target in this case would be, for the Titanic data set, would be did the person survive or not? And then we can look, well, is there a relation between sex and if the person survived or not? Is there a correlation between age and if the person survived or not, et cetera, et cetera? Assessed interactions between all variables. Well, is there, for example, like, we would, for example, see that there would be a relation between age and if the people survived or not, and also, or rather, let's say there would be an interaction between the cabin, no, the passenger class and if the person survived or not, and there's an interaction between the price the person paid and if the person survived or not. But if we see that there's also really strong correlation between the price they paid and the class, the passenger class they were in, we see that this is a common cause, right? And we see that only one of these variables is the real source of both of the others, like we did in the first neural informatics lectures. Yeah, interactions between variables, and then, well, explore data across many dimensions and have many different combinations of variables to look at if there's something useful. So yeah, exploratory data analysis is very important, as we cannot judge whether our modeling makes sense if we don't have an intuition, like I just said. And every analysis should start with exploratory data analysis. So yeah, let's start for our exploratory data analysis with pivot tables. So like I said, we want to look, for example, if the passenger class made a difference on if the passengers of the Titanic survived. We looked already at pivot tables. We looked at the group by. And basically, a pivot table is simply a two-dimensional group by. So let's look at our normal group by first. So we wanted to group by sex and then take the mean. This takes the mean of every single column, group by male or female. So we see, for example, that if we look at survived, the average here is much higher for females than for males. So we see, using this group by, that females survived with a much, much higher chance than males. And also, they, for example, paid a much higher price than males on average. Stuff like this. But what if we wanted to analyze the influence of gender and the passenger class on survival? So we had to group by sex and passenger class and then take the mean. So this creates this two-dimensional series, which I don't like, so I'm going to reset the index to make it a data frame. This looks very much nicer. And we see that a female in the highest class survived with 96% chance, a female in the lowest class still survived with 50% chance, a male in the highest class only had a chance of one-third to survive, and in the lower classes was basically dead. So we see, yes, so the sex and the passenger class both are strong indicators for if the person survived or not. And women and children first seems to be, have been really the case in the Titanic. In fact, it really was, they even let go lifeboats which were not completely filled because there were no women and children left to put on these boats. Oh gosh, how stupid they were. But yeah, I read that on Wikipedia. blah blah blah. We can. Ah, yeah. This is the tidy format which Rüdiger showed you last week. This, if you're used to this, you can read it intuitively. However, most of us still prefer this two-dimensional thing. So let's unstack that to make it two-dimensional, and we now have cells for this. And this is the nicest way to look at, well, what are the influence of sex and passenger class on if the person survived or not. And because this is the nicest way, and this is done by quite a bit of method chaining, Pandas simply provides a shortcut for that, which is called pivot table. So this pivot table simply does the same as its two-dimensional group by. We have values, so this is what we want to extract out of it. We have an index, which is what's put as the column index and as the row index, and we have the columns, which is the passenger class, which we also had here. So this is the very same thing as this. Good thing about pivot tables, they can also include the margins, so the values aggregated over rows and columns. So the aggregation, so the mean of all females surviving and of all males surviving. So we looked at this already a bit up. So we see the birth survived. So females had an 0.74% chance, where males had an 18% chance. And where am I? And yeah, 0.74 and 0.18% chance. So overall, all passengers had a 38% chance of surviving. And yeah, first class much higher than second class, much higher than second class, than third class. Just all the stuff we want to know in there. Okay, by default, our pivot table will aggregate. So as we saw here, for group by, we needed to tell we want to have the mean as aggregation function. Group by pivot table standard uses the mean, but we can also use all other functions that are available in group by, and also more than one. For example, we can use the min and the max, but only for the price now. It will give me basically two data frames stacked into one, and it gave me the minimum price. So there are many, wow, so there are always males who didn't need to pay for their ticket, but females always needed to pay. But yeah, the highest price, at least for the first class, was the same for males and females, and for the third one too. So yeah, just useful as exploratory data analysis, we can figure out so much about a data set doing this. Yeah, we can also aggregate multiple values in the same pivot table. I already showed you this basically for the group by. It's basically this egg func is the same as it is in group by. Okay, yes, we can combine more than two variables. So this is obvious. So right, we see that we have only the sex and the passenger class here. We can combine more than two variables by simply having stacking them either in the rows or in the columns. And now we have females and the embarked city and the columns in the rows and the fare in the columns, the passenger class in the columns. And here the fare. So obviously, this seems to be the longest ride, this seems to be the second longest ride, and this seems to be the shortest ride or something. Yeah, let's make our age coarse in case it wasn't there anymore. And then there's also this nice tool, this pivot table JavaScript, which allows us to quickly explore our data with pivot tables using drag and drop. So this is a nice first step to do because it's simply so easy to use. So I could, for example, give me, I want survived in the rows, said in the rows, and I want the sex in the columns, and as values, I want the average of the survivors. Oh no, my this doesn't make sense. It's a passenger class. Yeah, this makes more sense. So I have passenger class now in the rows, sex in the columns, and I could add even more stuff into the columns. So, for example, of course, age, that makes it two dimensional. And I can, okay, I don't know, I can take the minimum set, can take the minimum, or let's say the maximum. Fair, check it here. Fair, and now this gives me the maximum fair by age, gender, and person. So there were no female seniors on there, but well, children. Wow, children need to pay more, but only female children. Oh no, this. Oh, what is this? What is this? I don't know. Ah, this is not. This is NA. Ah, it includes the NAs. Okay, no, so children did not need to pay more. They paid less than grown-ups. But seniors paid far less than all of them. Wow, okay, interesting. So yeah, useful tool. But the problem is, if I now close and reopen my Jupyter again, well, it's gone, right? So don't rely on this tool, just use it to explore your data, and after you did that, create a pivot table using a script, because the script is not going to be lost when you restart. So let's do that right now. Use the pivot table to check if women and children first was taken seriously on the Titanic. Yeah. So obviously we want to get the women and the children. So sex and age course. So yeah, simply call a pivot table, including the margins, because I want to see the margins with the age course and the sex. So, and what do we see here? Wait, what was it? So children had 0.38, grown-ups 0.53, and this is in fact the wrong way around. So children had a chance of 0.54 to survive, like the weighted mean of this. Grown-ups had a chance of 0.38 to survive, the weighted mean of this. Way more intuitive that it's this way around. And does your pandas also calculate it this way around? Yes. Yeah, I have no clue why pandas does that. Wait for the next version to fix that, because this is obvious an error. I have no clue why that is the case. And if we group by age course and take then the mean of survive, we see that, well, pandas knows that the mean for the children is 53 and the mean for the grown-ups is 38. Apparently there's an error in pandas right now. Maybe it's fixed in the next version. Or does anybody know why this happens or why this would make sense? It doesn't, right? It doesn't make sense to me either. So yeah, seems to be wrong in the current version of pandas. I am not sure why it's. Okay, and then last thing for today, which is good because my voice is already gone, almost gone, profiling. So exploratory data analysis makes sense, and you should always do this. But it's always the same basic, like almost always the same, no matter which data set you have, which is why there are tools like Pandas Profiling, which simply create summaries giving insights into all the standard questions we may have to concerning data set. However, always remember that with exception, and this is what it does because it treats every single data set I put in there the same, more exception means less flexibility. So tools like this will always do part of the work and might at times not do at all what we want, because it doesn't know the way the variables are stored in there, and I can only figure that out by looking at the data. So more automation means more abstraction, means less flexibility. It makes assumptions about my data sets. For example, that this embarked is a string and not a category if we take it simply from a CSV file. And this is not good, and it's not perfect. Yeah. This profile report is really huge. So it gives many informations. So the number of variables, these are the columns, observation, this is the number of rows. This is a total, I'm not sure right now if it's the total rows or the total values to figure that out. It gives me the size of memory, the size of one record in memory. And then it gives me, well, these are the variable types. So we have quite a few categorical here, which it inferred itself. And then it also gives me warning, for example, missing values. So we see here age has many missing values, like we already figured out. Age course has the same amount of missing values. Cabin has even far more than that. Cabin. So pandas, this pandas profiling assumes this is a categorical. So as we see, there's only one text here, which is the passenger name. And because pandas profiling notices that the cabin is too high cardinality, it said, yeah, I assume these are categories, but then it noticed where these are many different categories. Yeah, and there are also many zeros here, blah, blah, blah. And then for every single variable, it gives me like the complete summarization. So what we saw already when doing value counts, the number of distinct counts, the number of uniques, how many are missing in percent as well as the absolute number, mean, minimum, maximum, whatever makes sense for that level of measurement. Pandas profiling assumes the variable is on. a histogram, and then it gives me even more statistics, standard deviation, mean absolute distance, all this stuff. This is a frequency, so this is what we see already. How pandas made that, right? How pandas profiling made that. The value count frequency, where we see, well, these are the most common ones, but well, these are by far not all, and many of them are missing too. The minimum values, the maximum values, blah, blah, blah. And that for all categories. So H course here, it assumes this was a categorical, well, this was certainly categorical. And for categorical, it doesn't have much information because for categories, well, what makes sense, like I said, the mean, the mode, not the mean, the mode and, yeah, well, the number of uniques, for example, this makes sense, but not much because it was categorical. The cabin, well, it was assumed by pandas profiling was categorical, but it wasn't a categorical variable, so it tries to do a bit of value count and stuff. Embarked long, both categoricals. Then we have the fair, which is a numeric, where pandas provides many more informations again. So most of them paid the lower price, only some paid the very, very high price we see. So quite a few paid nothing, quite a few paid okay, one paid like $5. And we see all this, this is a unique categorical, so it noticed that names are unique, so it didn't want to make it categorical the way it did the others. And yeah, it are unique, so all the frequencies are one. And so on for all the variables. So this is like a very, very long report, but it makes total sense. Look at this. And then, like I said, step one is to look at individual variables. Step two is to look at combinations of variables. And these are, for example, correlations. And it shows me the correlations using Pearson and Spearman. And we see where the fair obviously correlates strongly with the fair and the index with the index, well, duh. The ID correlated with the index, well, because both were increasing numbers. But what we see also, for example, here, survived correlates with the passenger class negatively. So the lower the passenger class, the higher the chance that you survived. The passenger class correlated negatively with the fare. The lower your passenger class, the more you had to pay. So these are the two things I already told you, right? And we see also the survived correlates positively with the fare. Because the more you paid, the higher your passenger class, the higher the chance you survived. Same thing for Spearman correlations, differently calculated. You had that in statistics, I too, but I forgot the way they were calculated. Luckily, there are tools for that. And yeah, and it also provides me a sample. Pandas profiling, really useful thing. Doesn't replace your own exploratory data analysis, but it's really useful as a first thing to look at this. And yeah, and then last thing, this is a tutorial about exploratory data analysis. It's 3 hours, it's useful to watch, tells you way more than I just did. And yeah, then I will see you on Thursday where we're working with time series data. Thank you.